So first, let me introduce myself. My name is Mathias Brandewinder. You can find me on Twitter as @Brandewinder. I usually look like this guy on the right, on GitHub, on Twitter, various places. My areas of interest are machine learning and F-sharp. I came late to software development. I initially was a C-sharp guy, moved to F-sharp like 5 years ago. Did it by curiosity. And I just fell in love with the language. And before that, I was into economics and applied math. You probably detected that I have a tiny bit of an accent. So I'm based in San Francisco. It's obviously a California accent. But originally, I'm from France. And so I just moved over there like 15 years ago. The weather was nice, and I just stayed. And if you want to know more, talk to me afterwards. So, where is this talk coming from? So this talk is coming from an actual experience. So what happened like 6 months ago, I did a machine learning competition with friends. And so what happened was we had like 6 or 7 people on the team, all of them like pretty qualified software engineers, very experienced, like they knew what they were doing. And so we started working together in the, on that machine learning competition. And probably 2 to 3 weeks after we started, the repository was an entire mess. It just, it was really like the type of thing where you just don't want people to see the type of code you have written. And so I thought like this was weird because we got like people who knew what they were doing, they were competent, and it took like in a couple of weeks, everybody did the wrong things and the code base was in a total state of disarray. So I thought like given that, is like we're probably doing something wrong and maybe it's worth thinking a bit about what is it that we're doing wrong, why we're doing it wrong and what we should do better. So this talk is really about this. So it's about, the first thing is like it's about the fact that usually when you walk alone, I think one of the things which was special here is like usually when you walk alone, you don't really need much of a process. You are doing your thing, it's all fine. And it's like the moments where you start to need a process is like when you have more than one person working on the same code base. So I think this is one of the reasons this was interesting because usually I do machine learning alone. Here we had many people together and this is how we saw that something was going wrong. The other thing which I think is interesting here is that when you do machine learning, what you do is it looks for all intents and purposes like what you do when you write code. That's what you do all the time. At the same time, is like so starting from this assumption, you should assume maybe that if you're writing code, everything you do normally with code will work. And so this forced me to revisit this a bit, and I also want to talk a bit about this. And think about the question of like, we're writing code in machine learning, but it's kind of different from what we're doing when we're writing a line of business application. So that's another line of thought. And the third one I wanted to explore a bit was specifically on the machine learning side. Most people end up using languages like Python, like R, maybe MATLAB, things like that. And I end up using F#, so a statically typed functional programming language. And I think it has a lot of benefits. It's a bit of an unusual stack, so I also wanted to discuss why I'm doing this and why maybe this would be interesting. And I'm going to make the claim that I'm not a complete idiot, so if I'm doing it, it's because it's having benefits for me, so I want to share this a bit, and maybe if you use other languages, that give you an idea why I think it's interesting. This is also based on an actual experience. It's not, so if you come here for the silver bullet on how you should do machine learning, this is not going to be it. These are like my thoughts at the time, they're still evolving, so unfinished. Finally, because people sometimes get stressed out and ask, where's the code, where's the code? All my code is on GitHub. So there are really two repositories here. One of them, the first one, is what we did for the competition, so you can see it. There is the good, the bad, and the ugly. Like this is really what we did. And the second one is like my repository where there is the material for this presentation. So what I'm going to talk about, or the way I'm going to approach it, is like in 4 steps. First, I'm going to describe a bit, so I told you this was a competition, I'm going to describe a bit what the problem was, what we were trying to solve. Then I'm going to talk a bit about building models and how you can go from the mess we had to trying to iteratively creating good models. Going to discuss a bit about data, because data is a big part of machine learning, and finally, like a couple of parting thoughts. So the competition was about, so it was on Kaggle. Kaggle is this website where you can, essentially they organize machine learning competitions. You have data, you don't know what to do with the data, you don't have data scientists or machine learning people. You just go to Kaggle, they put it online and they tell you like the goal of the competition is to predict this. And then it's like, you do your model, other people do their model, and may the best one win. May the best man win. Sometimes you win nothing, sometimes there is money to be won. So this particular competition was for a company called Home Depot. So if you don't know Home Depot, like Home Depot is the place where you go if you want to buy a hammer, if you want to buy a saw, if you want to buy toilets, if you want to buy a shower, if you want to buy like all sorts of paints, like all that type of stuff. And if you go to Home Depot, like most websites, you have something like this. On the website, you have a little box, and you type in, this is what I'm looking for, and you press this, and it's going to give you back what, like the recommendations from Home Depot for what you were looking for. And in essence, the competition was about figuring out if yes or no the recommendations were any good. So I mentioned like this was a team effort, so I'm going to mention some of my teammates. We were a bunch of people, actually seven, not six. And the two main people who contributed besides me were a guy called Jamie Dixon, that's his handle, and the other one, Taylor Wood, that's his handle. And so we did pretty good. So it was the competition was a very fairly intense one. Part of the reason was I think there were $40,000 for the winner. So that tends to motivate people. So a lot of teams participated. At the height of the competition, there were over 2,100 people competing. And we didn't end up first. We didn't win any money. It was still fun, but so we didn't win. We ended up like 122 out of 2,000, so like a top 6%, which I think is pretty respectable. Actually, for the stories, like we ended up initially under 5%, which was my goal. I was super excited. And then what happened was they realized that some people cheated on the competition, and so they started to eliminate some of the teams. And as a result, is that our ranking started to go down because some people were removed from the list. So this was really saddening. It's like one of these moments where we did everything right and the cheaters were not the ones who were punished, like we were punished. So sad story here. So what I said was that the competition was about the search box on Home Depot. And so this is what the question was. Like if I go to Home Depot and I type like I want something, maybe I want something like a 6-inch damper, whatever that means, I press the button. And something is ready to come back, and that's a list of products. And so let's say the first product is this thing. It's a Batik Door Energy Conservation Products Premium 6-inch Backdraft Damper. I have no idea what that means, but this is what comes back. And so the question here is like, you get the product back. Is this a good or a bad recommendation coming from Home Depot? So what we had to address that question was the following. Like we had a big data set. The data set was, of course, a CSV file because it's always a CSV file. And the CSV file looked more or less like this. You had a long list of things which were like, this is the product which came back. For instance, Simpson, strong tie, blah, blah, blah. You had the query which the person entered, L bracket. And you had a number, and the number was like from 1 to 3. Was this a terrible recommendation? Was this a great recommendation? So we had like, I can't remember how many, but like many of these. So the problem we have here is really this. If given a search, like a string of what the user searched for, and given a product which was returned or recommended by Home Depot, predict how relevant the recommendation is. And so relevant would be like how good it was for the search. And the relevance is rated from 1, terrible, to 3, awesome, 2 being meh, is that kind of okay, but not exactly what I wanted. So that's what we are after. We want to predict relevance given to search strings. What we had for the competition was this. We had 70,000 training examples, so queries and results. The goal was to predict for 20,000 search on products, we had to predict the relevance for these ones, and you were rated on RMSE, so that's the root mean square error. It doesn't really matter, but like what you're really trying to do is you're trying to get on average a response which is as close as possible to the correct response. And we had 3 months to do that, and 2,000 people trying to do better than us. So this is a machine learning competition, so I figured I should talk a bit about machine learning. So I'm going to start with something which is not machine learning, and I'm going to start with approaching it as a software engineer. And so what I'm really trying to do is something along these lines. I'm starting with an observation. So an observation is something which is going to have a search or search string, which is a string, returns a product, which is a string. So this is what I have. And out of this, I'm trying to build something which is going to take this and give me back a number between 1 and 3. And one thing I could do, I could write an implementation here. So this is a F# code, so it's pretty short and everything, but hopefully it's clear. I can write a prediction function, which is going to take an observation and give me back a 2. And so this is great because, like in one line of code, I'm done. So the point here is like if I show you the code before, you could say yes, it's done, but like obviously it's not done, right? It's like I have something which is fits the specification to a T. I have the input, I have the output, I have a prediction function, and yet I could even write tests for this. Like I could tell you that it's working, and yet it's like we're completely missing the mark. Like this is obviously not what we're trying to do. Like if I ship this, it's like I'm going to do terrible in the competition, and I'm just not doing any of what I was trying to do. So the question now is like what's the problem here? So first comment on this is like usually on the line of business application, you're going to spend most of your time modeling the domain. This is what's hard. Here the domain is completely trivial, like I'm done in like 3 lines, finished. So this is not where the problem is. Second one is like, on this particular case I wrote, I could write a unit test, it's going to be completely unhelpful. Like checking that the number my function gives me back is not what I'm after. So correctness of the code is not exactly what I'm after. So the question here would be like, if this is not what we're doing, what is it that we're trying to do? And so what we're probably going to do, like what the process looks like when you are doing machine learning is something along these lines. We are trying to write a function predict, but what we're going to do is like over 3 months, we're going to write and rewrite that function over and over and over again. Like it's the same piece of functionality, but we're going to keep tweaking that functionality. And the way we're going to doing this is we're going to be creative, and the goal is to be creative and come to a prediction function which is not correct in the sense of there is no unit test, but we want something which performs better. And performs better means like I'm really trying to do something which is going to give me an answer which is close to what the data tells me. So I'm not trying to, I don't have an exact answer, I'm trying to get closer and closer to an ideal goal. So what this means, like a couple of maybe comments here. First one is like unlike most of the code you typically write, I don't have many features, I have one single feature, that's it. So I'm going to be writing for 3 months on the same feature day in, day out. That's the predict function. My function or my feature is never complete. It's like I don't have a moment where the predict function is done. It's like I'm going to have a result and then I can improve it and improve it and improve it. But at no point in time will I have something which will be closed and done and I can go. The other thing which is interesting is like typically on a typical line of business applications, you're going to build one feature, done, another one, done, another one, done, and at some point they're all put together and you finish and you move on with your life. Here we have one feature, but we will probably write many experiments, many versions of that feature, and we're probably even going to run them in parallel to compare them together. So it's like, imagine that your code base with everything is forks and you're just having like only forks of your code base. That's what we're doing here. And nothing is correct. It's like you don't have a perfect model. There is no good and bad idea. The metric will be, are we doing better on prediction? So in that sense, it's like it's not about whether the idea is good. There is no good or bad idea. The only way to know if the idea is good is to look, code it, run it, and see the results. And if it works, it's a good idea. No matter how stupid it sounds, like if it's better, it's better. And if it's a great idea on paper but it doesn't work, it's like it doesn't matter if it sounds great. It's just a waste of time. So given that, given this point, is like the point I'm trying to make here is like while we're writing code, is like the type of activity we're doing is fairly different from the way you would write a typical application, like building one feature, one feature, one feature until you're done. And the word I brought up was experiments. And so the reason I brought it was like if we are not writing code the same way we are for a line of business application, chances are the process you use for a line of business application is not going to work in this context. And so I figured like maybe a good idea is to take a step back and look at if writing code is not the right place to look for inspiration, maybe we should look in another place. And so I used this word experiments before, and so that's what I'm going to explore right now. And what we're going to do is we're going to look at another area which does similar things to machine learning, and that would be the world of science. And so if you take what a scientist does, a scientist usually cares about something. We all care about something, but so typically you care about a phenomenon. Maybe I'm trying to predict if the moon is going to be full tomorrow. Maybe I'm trying to predict if that rock is going to fall fast or slow. So I'm concerned about a phenomenon, something you observe, and I'm going to try to make a prediction. So what you really want as a physicist or as a scientist is you want something along these lines. I have observations, like I have my rock. I'm going to pass it into a model, like whatever that model is, typically mathematical, and this is going to give me a prediction, like that rock is going to fall in 2 seconds, in 5 seconds, something like that. To be a bit more specific, what we really want is something slightly different. We don't really care about an observation and a prediction. What we're going to do as a physicist is say, I have a rock. Out of that rock, I'm actually going to extract out some pieces of data which I think might be useful in creating a prediction. So I'm going to extract maybe x1, that might be the weight, x2, that might be the shape, like shape is not really a number, but like, so I'm extracting out a couple of numbers out of my observation. Then I'm going to pass it into a model, and what a model is really a function. So that function is going to take all the input I extracted and I think are useful, and out of this I'm going to get a number y, which is the prediction. So really what I'm doing is I'm looking at the world and I'm trying to transform it into a model where I'm extracting numbers, passing it into a function and getting a number out of this. This is what a physicist does roughly. I hope I'm not insulting physicists by oversimplifying it. So what we're doing here is like we're really formulating a model. So we are saying like I'm observing all these things. I presume that this is behaving a certain way which I'm going to represent mathematically. For instance, one model could be I have like the sun, or I have the Earth, and then I have all the planets describing circles around it, and this is one possible model, which is probably not great. I have another model, which we have the sun, and then planets describing circles, so I'm representing things in a mathematical language. And the next step will be, now that I have this idea of how the world works, this is all great, but this is just an opinion at that point, to use the theme that Aliostad was using in an earlier talk. And so what I want now is I want to see if my theory is holding. And the way I'm going to check that is by bringing hard data to the table. And so what I'm going to do is I'm going to say, I have this model and now I have observations. I dropped a rock, it dropped in 2 seconds. Another rock dropped in 2 seconds. So I have this whole data set. And what I'm going to try to do is trying to see if the data fits with my model. So the next step will be calibrating. So the calibration would be, I have like a data set, like the prototypical calibration model would be, I look at my data, I think it looks like a straight line, I'm going to look at all my points, and I'm going to try to find parameters such that the line fits the data I have. So I'm finding, given my hypothesis and given the data, this is the best shape I can find for my model. And then it's like I'm not done, because so far what I did was, like given the data, this is the best I can do so far to fit the data to the model. And now the way you can check if your idea is actually correct is by making predictions about the future. So in essence, like the proof of the pudding is in the eating. So it's like if I have a model and my model is making predictions for tomorrow, and tomorrow the moon is not full and I predict it was full, then my model is probably wrong. If it fits, it might be correct. So this is, I love this quote. Like, so this is a quote which is attributed to Niels Bohr. Prediction is very difficult, especially if it's about the future, so that's really the point. So it's like in the end, it's like I don't care about model fitting the data in the past, I'm trying to do something which is going to make predictions about the future. The other thing I like about this, so you can probably not see this, but here I have a little, so this was picked from the picture from Wikipedia, and I had to show this because this is the best quotation for, caption for a picture I ever saw. So what this says, so Niels Bohr was one of these great physicists, I think he was Danish, and so that's a picture of Niels Bohr. And what the caption says is like photograph showing the head and shoulders of a man in a suit and tie. And I just love this caption because it's like it's both entirely correct and completely pointless. Like it's just a... So anyways, so it's like at that point it's like we have a model, we have data, and we calibrated it, we checked if it fit the data, and if it does, at that point we're going to say, okay, that model looks good enough, and it will become the current best truth. And it's going to be the best truth until I can find something which does better than my current model. So this is kind of what a physicist does or a scientist does at a high level. Process would be one, formulate a model, like describe the model mathematically, calibrate, I have data, I'm trying to fit it to the data, and then validate, look at the future or other data and see if it does any good on new data. And so this is, I think this is relevant because this is exactly what a machine learning or data scientist person does. So machine learning is really what a physicist does, but like in code. What I'm going to do, it just has like slightly different names, is like instead of formulating a model, what I'm going to do is like it's called feature extraction or feature engineering. I'm going to take my data set and I'm going to try to extract numbers out of this. Then I'm going to calibrate a model. The calibration is what machine learning people call learning. I'm going to try to fit the model to the data, and validation is still called validation. To go a bit in detail, the first step, modeling, typically what it involves is something along these lines. I'm going to take an observation. For instance, in my case, I have like a search query on a product description, and I'm going to transform it into a vector because it's easier to work with numbers than with text. And so in this case, for instance, I could say what matters is like how long was the search, how many matching words did I have, like did it contain the letter A, like whatever. And out of these, I'm going to extract a vector, which is numbers describing my my observation. And so what I want now is I want to learn a function f, which gives me out of that vector maps to the relevance from 1 to 3. The learning part is where people get all obsessed. It's like, should you do deep learning? Should you do this? Should you do that? It's like, in the end, it's like it's all algorithms. You have many you can choose. So this is coming from Scikit, which has a cheat sheet. And really what this is telling you is like, hey, if you have a lot of data, if you don't have enough data, get more. If you have that type of data, do this, do that, do that. And so you have like this whole branching, like where for a particular type of problem, you can use one, two, or three algorithms. So you might also, there is not one algorithm, you might use many of them. So that's kind of the point here. And the validation, so that's one of the good things about living in the 21st century and not in the Middle Ages like Galileo, is like back in the days, it was difficult to get data. Today, we have like typically a lot of data, even maybe big data, who knows. And so one thing you can do is like instead of having to wait and run experiments, and one thing I could do with a Home Depot is I could do a model, run it in production and see if it works. That's obviously going to be slow, painful. One thing I could do, which is easier, is I could take a lot of data, take half of it to learn my model, take the other half for the validation. So this is what people call validation or cross-validation. So just by splitting my data set, I can accelerate a lot the experiment validation just by running on my current data set. So recap. What I try to show here is like the fact that there is a difference, a fundamental difference in the what. While we are both writing code, machine learning people and people who write line of business application do a fundamentally different activity. When you write traditional software, traditional quote unquote, you're really building up a collection of discrete features. Like at some point, feature one is done, feature two is done, you plug them together and you have an application. In machine learning, you're really creating experiments, trying to improve all the time that single feature until you get a good result. And so the traditional process you follow is probably not going to work. Like Scrum is not going to work, Waterfall is not going to work, all these things are just not going to work out because it just looks very different. So this is kind of the theory. Now is like, let's look a bit at the practice and like what people do when they do machine learning. So the typical machine learning person is going to work a lot in scripts. And following kind of what I was describing before, a typical machine learning script is going to look along these lines, like with variations, but it's kind of variations on the same thing. You're going to start with, you will need data to learn and to validate. So first, you're going to have to load the data. Then you're going to have to extract features as vectors, as I showed it. So take the data and transform it. Then you're going to have to plug in an algorithm, whatever that is. Like that could be a neural network, that could be a support vector machine, it doesn't really matter. But you're going to take that data, put it into the algorithm, let it learn a model, and then you're going to do the last thing, which is check, again, the validation data, check if it's doing good or bad at predicting whatever you're trying to predict. So this is kind of what you're doing. And so I'm going to show you like in practice how this looks. So I'm going to show you like a slightly simplified script, which is coming from our competition. So I have my data set like somewhere here. And here, so what I'm going to start with, I have my observations, which are search and the product description. And what I want is I want to use, to transform it into numbers, which are going to describe that search. So I don't know really what's right or wrong, so I could try many things. I could try like how long the search is, how many words I have, many things are possible. How many matching words. So first thing, loading the data. I'm going to do this here. So I'm using F# here on VS Code using the wonderful Ionide extension. And so loading the data is going to be as simple as this. So this is where like F# is kind of nice. I'm going to use a type provider. And so like in my four lines of code, I have my data ready to use and loaded. So that's fine. That's good. I should probably show the data set. So this is the data set I'm loading right now. Like this is what I'm using, like as I described, like a search term, product, and all of this. So that's what I'm loading now and what I'm going to be working on. So first step, loading the data, done. Second one is like I want to transform, not this one, I want the other one. My starter model is here. Why is this not happening? Okay, here we go. Next step is, like I said, I want to extract features. So the way, what I need is I want to take every observation and transform it into vectors. That's not too difficult to do. So the way I could do this is I'm out of all these records, what I need is I need to extract an output and an input. So the input is going to be transforming every row into numbers and the output is going to be a number. So I'm going to take my data set, and here for every single row, I'm going to take the output is going to be the relevance, like the number between 1 and 3. And out of the input, I'm going to extract out like some features. So in this case, why not? I'm going to say, I'm going to predict the relevance using the search term length, like how many words or how many characters the user typed, and how long the product description was. Whether it's good or bad, I don't know. It's probably a stupid model, but like that's, I would start there and then maybe transform it. So so let's run this. So now it's like the first step, transformation is done. Now it's like I have data, which I can start working on. So next step would be the learning part. So here I'm going to use a library called Accord, and I'm going to use a logistic regression. Doesn't really matter, the details don't really matter. It's like one of the many ways I could learn out of data. But this is where things are going to start to become a bit messy. Because like one of the problems here is like my numbers, I have actually no idea why they did this. It's like the relevance is going from 1 to 3. It's like, why not 0 to 1? Why not 0 to 100? I don't know. But the fact is like many algorithms use different forms of output. And as it happens, logistic regression is expecting the output to be between 0 and 1. So now it's like what I need to do is I need to take my relevance from 1 to 3 and move it to 0 to 1. So I'm going to do this here. Like I'm saying like remove 1, divide by 2. This is going to normalize it to 0 to 1. Done. And now I can plug things into my logistic regression. So this is my algorithm here. And I'm going to let it learn. So the learning is simply, essentially, is going to take my model and change the parameters progressively, trying to match better and better and better the data I have. So I'm learning, now I have a model which is ready. And the next step would be, is this model any good? And the way I'm going to check it is I'm going to create a prediction function. And I'm going to take an input, take the same features, pass it into the regression, and renormalize the numbers from 1 to 3. And now I can compute for each of the observations I have. What I'm going to do here is I'm going to say, look at the actual number from 1 to 3. Look at what the prediction says from 1 to 3. Essentially, take the difference. And like the bigger the difference, the worse the number. So like if I have a perfect model, I should get 0. And if I have a bad model, it should go up. So here, I have a number which tells me like on average, I'm 1.5 out or away from the correct prediction. So if you think about it for a minute, this means that my model here is absolutely awful because I'm trying to predict a number between 1 and 3, and on average, I'm off by 1.5. So this is pretty much as bad as it could get. So but the point here is like not to build a great model, but to show you like how we build a model. So given that, though, is like this is so the good thing here is like first, like it fits what I described. Second is like in about 80 lines of code, I have a full script which is doing exactly what I want, and I'm getting a bad model, but I'm getting a model. Now, the next step would be our model is not perfect, so the next step would be like how do we make our model better? And so we could do a couple of things here. The first thing I could do is I just used like two features, like how long the search was and how long the product description was. I could start adding and removing features. I could say maybe I should look at how many words match in the input and the output. Maybe I could do this, I could do that. I could do many things. The other thing I could do is I could use a different algorithm. I use the logistic regression. I could use a support vector machine, a network, like whatever you want. So these are the two things I could do to start to improve my results. So this is good. This is probably where I want to go. And now, it's like, if you look at it from the standpoint of a software engineer, this is probably where you're going to see where this is going to hurt. This is really going to hurt because that script is working as is, but it's going to be extremely painful to update. The reason it's going to be painful is this. Like, the first one is the way I defined my features was here. So I have my features here. So now, it's like, if I want to add a new feature, I'm going to have to put it in one place. But I will also have to put it in a second place, like the place where I'm doing the predictions, which was here. So now it's like this is really a blatant, terrible code duplication. Every time I change my model, I have to fix it in two places. And if I do that, there is a very good chance that bugs are going to crop in. It's not going to be very fun. The other part where it's going to be fun, not fun, is that if I'm trying to change my algorithm. So here I'm using a logistic regression. If I'm using another algorithm, like maybe a support vector machine expects number between -1 and +1. So I also need to change the way I'm normalizing my data. Maybe some other algorithms expect other things. So I need to start to change things in lots of places. And as a result, I'm going to spend a lot of time working on deduplicating things and potentially introducing bugs in the process. As a result, what happened in our repository was after 2 weeks, everybody did different scripts. There was no shared code, and like you had like 20 different scripts in the repository, no way to see what was going on, and full of bugs. If you take another step back, so that's already a practical problem, and you can probably see why things might go not very well if you do scripts in an undisciplined manner. The second problem you're going to have is the following. So if you come a bit from a DDD background, it's like there is this idea of an ubiquitous language where you should be striving for, like your code should be telling the same story as the story you're telling your customers or the stakeholders. And here, what I described initially was features, algorithms, learning, all these things. And if you look at my script, I can see none of these things. Like, I don't have anywhere features. I don't really see, so the script I have is completely mismatched with the description I gave for my domain. So that's also a bit of a problem. Like, this is a smell that probably what I'm doing is not completely right. So I think this is where a lot of our problems were coming from. So now that I showed this, the problems are I can't see my features, I can't swap my algorithms. I'm also going to repeat the same steps everywhere, like loading data, computing the error. So this is not good, and we probably want to do something a bit different. This is another way to describe this, is like the process we're following right now is extremely wasteful. It's wasteful, so wasteful would be using something carelessly with no purpose, and that's what we're doing. We're going to spend a lot of time fixing code which has no value, while not being able to focus on the place where we might actually deliver value. So to avoid waste, what we probably want is like to get to a process or get to a place where if we have a lot of volatility in one area, we should be able to swap out things very easily in these places, and places which are repeatable and which are like dumb and mechanical, we should automate them to death. So this is what we try to do. We try to use types to represent the domain we were after. We try to automate everything which was not changing. That's like things like loading the data, validating the evaluation, and all these things. And on the other hand, we try to focus on making it possible to change very easily the things which are important, and that would be the features, like extracting features. And as it turned out, it was actually pretty easy. And like it took me like a glorious like 1 or 2 days to get there. So we ended up with a model along these lines. Like the core model we are after, so this is F# code, pretty short. It's kind of nice that the whole model literally fits on like one slide. So what I have is I still have observations with the string, with a search and a product. What I'm after is I'm trying to predict a relevance, which is a float. What I'm trying to get is I'm trying to build a predictor. What a predictor is, it's a function which is going to take an observation and give me relevance out. That's what we're trying to create. To do this, we're going to use features. And a feature, in the end, is also a function. It's a function which is going to take an observation and transform it into a number. Like, give me a feature, and the first feature could be number of words, that's a number, blah, blah, blah. So I just, every feature is a function. What I have to work with is a catalog of examples, and an example is an observation which happens to have attached to it the relevance. So I know the observation, and I know what the result was. And finally, what I'm really after is I'm going to build a model, and the model is redefined by a collection of features, and I'm going to the learning phase is going to take a model, which is my features, take a collection of examples, and give me back a predictor. And that's pretty much all there is to machine learning. You could even argue that every single machine learning problem under the sun fits in that model, which fits in one slide. What this gives me is like something really nice, because now that I defined a feature as a function with a specific shape, I can start defining something, the catalog of features. Like I have a first feature, which is how long was the search? It's a function. I have a product title, length, it's also a function. I could start to do more complex one, like how many words match between the input and the output. Is like that's also a function, which also gives me a float. And the thing which is really nice here is that I can build this in a separate file. I can share it in the team. I write a script, you write a script, another person writes a script. We are going to share the same catalog of features. We agree on how they are defined, and we can reuse code across implementations. So this is pretty neat. And we can version what we're doing. And so now, out of this, what I get is I get a super clean way to represent an experiment. So at that point, it's like instead of having like 80 lines of code which are doing everything from the learning to the loading of data to the validation, I really have an experiment which is going to be a tiny bit of code to load the data in a common way. Then I'm going to say my model is going to be that feature, that feature, that feature, learn using a specific algorithm. So here I'm using a couple of adapters around classic algorithms. And then I can compute the quality in the same way across all my experiments. So I know that architects like boxes, like if you don't do it with boxes, you're not doing it right. So I thought I would do like a boxy diagram to show a bit what I'm doing. It's like, in a sense, like instead of having a bunch of scripts which are just floating around in a folder, what I have here is like I separated my problem in a couple of ways. It's like on the left-hand side is like I'm isolating things I'm going to reuse, and there are really two things I care about. One of them is a catalog of features, so I'm building up feature 1, 2, 3, blah, 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 blah. And the second one is I have a catalog of algorithms I can use, algorithm 1, 2, 3, blah, 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 blah. And then every experiment is going to be a script, which is going to follow exactly the same structure, grab the data, then my experiment is going to be, I'm going to pull this feature and that algorithm, put it together and do the same validation. And so now this is neat because the only thing I need to do essentially is like decide which algorithm I'm going to use, which features I'm going to use, run it, see the result. Is it good? Yes. Keep it and do more of this. It doesn't work. Kill that experiment or do another one. So it's doing exactly what I want. It's like I'm not wasting time. I'm focusing completely on creating features, swapping out algorithms and see if it works or it doesn't work. So to show you that I'm maybe not lying, or like not completely lying, I'm going to show you like how it looks when it's finished. So instead of this ugly script I had originally, now is like what I have is the way the code base looks is this way. I have a core model, which is exactly what I described, observation, relevance, predictor, blah, blah, blah. So it's like exactly what I, it's not like I made it up, like the slide is exactly what I have in my code base. I have a catalog of feature, and so that catalog of features looks like this. I have a file, which is version, where people can see what changes and use some features, share them across models. So these are my features. And now I can use it into one experiment. So an experiment is going to look along these lines. So I'm going to load my, so let me do that. I can load my dependencies. So this is a bit ugly, I apologize for this. Like, But like that's the gist of my model. I can say my model is going to be this feature, and this feature. I'm going to plug in a logistic regression. I'm going to, and now it's like this is learned. And now I can check how good or how bad my model is. So if I run it here, I'm going to get a model which gives me 0.53. And to illustrate the point that I'm now very agile, is like I said, this is good. Maybe I should add matching words. So let's do that. I can now say this, like uncomment this. So now it's like I'm adding one feature to my model. And the question is like, is it better or worse? I can do that, learn again, and see how good or how bad this is. And this is, I think, slightly better than before. So the point here is like now is like forget about loading data, forget about all this ugly code. I'm strictly focusing on the piece I care about, which is like easily creating different models by plugging features and plugging algorithms. Yeah, so food for thought maybe quickly, a couple of comments. Like one thing which worked really well here was like using types. So this is where I like F# over maybe loosely typed languages like Python or R. Is like this was really nice because like I defined early on like the exact shape of my problem, used a couple of types, and now is like I know that I can't even run an experiment if it's not properly specified. So this gave me a very clean specification, and it took me literally half a day to a day to just write that part. So this, it's not even that costly. The thing which is kind of interesting maybe is that typically you spend your time modeling the entities in your domain, and here in the end what we modeled was not the domain but more the process we are following. And another point was I said that we can't really use tests. So the thing which is important here is like we're not using tests but we're using validation. So the theory on tests is like you should, everybody would agree that you should at some point write tests to see if it's working, but like in the end is like you write code, and if you don't write the test, if it builds, you can still entertain the illusion that maybe it works. Like in this specific case, the only way I know whether I'm going in the right track or the wrong track is by running my model, comparing it to the data, and seeing if it's doing any good at predictions. And so that's the cross-validation process, and it's playing exactly the same role your unit test suite or your test suite will be playing in your standard application, except that I really have to run the tests, otherwise I have no idea if what I did is actually working. So that's maybe one benefit of the machine learning area. We need to pass on this. So did it work? It did work really well. So as I said, it took me one day to rewrite the whole harness this way. Took me then a bit of a week, because then there was a bit of refactoring, because we had like a gazillion scripts everywhere. I had to refactor everything. So it was a bit of a painful week, but after that it was awesome, because suddenly we were in a place where the whole team was sharing the features, like everybody was remote, and we started to ship like models like crazy. Like what happened was the first 2 weeks of disorder were great, because people were shipping a lot of tests, so like, there was a high velocity, and at some point the velocity started to go down because it was just very hard to change anything. So, and after the refactoring, is like we shipped maybe like 10 models a day, compared them, and like so we went into a cadence which was like ship, and see if it works, and we were improving the rankings all the time. So it worked really well for us. So recap. Types with F-sharp and a statically typed language were really very effective at capturing the domain with a common language which you could share across scripts. And what we did was like just splitting the code elements by roles so that we could actually forget about the parts which are boring, like loading data and doing the same thing all over again and again and again. And we were able to then focus really on what we wanted, which was creating features and see if they work or not. So that was a success. So at that point, is you say, great, so now it's like you're done, you just ship features and everything works and life is good. And life was not quite that good. A couple of weeks went great, and then at some point we started to hit a wall again. And the reason we hit a wall was data. So there is this concept or this idea in science and in machine learning, which is the idea of reproducible research. So the idea of reproducible research is like, if I tell you, look, my model works great and has like 97% accuracy or whatever result, you might trust me blindly because I'm a nice guy and I look trustworthy, but you should probably be like St. Thomas and believe only things you can see. And so reproducible research, the idea is like you should be able to take the whole experiment. If I tell you it's 97%, you should be able to run it and get 97% on your machine. And so to do that, there is something interesting here, which is there are really two parts in my model. One part is like the model itself, like the features, the algorithm, and the second part is the data. And that's kind of unusual compared to building a line of business application. If you build an application, I'm assuming you're not putting your whole SQL server in your repository, because that's not really part of the application. The application is the application, and the data can be isolated. Here, if I tell you it's 97%, the result is this or that, you need two things. You need the code, and you need the data as well. And so you want to be in a place where you can also version the data and version whatever transformation you did to the data. And as a result, is like what you really want is like to essentially have a script, like at any time you should be able to run code and script the whole process from A to Z to see the result you expect. So maybe as a loose analogy, this is kind of similar to source control and automated build. You would be able to go to the source code, go to the GitHub repository, run it, and it should give you the same result I told you would get. So this is what we're after. And so now, why was it a problem in our case? I'll go back to the statement of the problem. So what we were trying to do was predict whether the quality of the recommendation was good. And essentially what we did for 3 months was this, was we tried to look at one assumption would be like, if I give you a result which looks like what you asked for, it's probably good. So the idea there was, does the search query look anything like the product you got back? And if I do that, like on paper, this looks simple. But if you start to look at the data, like there are a lot of small problems happening. Like, so this is the data set, and so as a first example, a search might be ductless air conditioners, and the result would be GRE, ultra, blah, 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 and I see ductless air conditioner here. So this looks like they should be similar. But like, if you look at these two strings, they're clearly not the same, right? It's like to you, this pot here looks similar to the pot I highlighted here. The problem here is that I have a capitalized duckless, I have capitalized A and capitalized conditioner. So if I really want to say like this is similar to this, I would probably want to do things about maybe lowercasing everything so that I can actually compare strength. It's not too difficult, I can just like make everything lowercase. But then I have a bit more complicated problems. You might have asked for something like a 6-inch damper, and the result is like batik door, blah, 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 blah. And here I have actually 6 inches. So this is similar, except that here 6 inch is written as 6IN dot. And so if you just blindly put it and say like, does this string match this string? It's going to tell you no. So I have also a lot of transformation to do now. It's like I have to transform like maybe inches, maybe squares, maybe kilograms, all these things. And the number of ways you can write these units is amazing. So there was a lot of work to start to normalize the units so that like an inch is an inch is an inch, no matter how you wrote it. You have like other tiny problems like this one here. Like if you're looking for a 10,000 BTU window air conditioner, so first like 10,000 is actually written with a comma here. So it's even numbers are not the same. You could even write, even numbers are complicated. So you have like the 1,000 separation. We discovered also that you could write, like suppose you want 1.5, say 1.5 centimeter. You could write it 1.5, 1.5, 150. So the number of ways you can write a number is amazingly diverse. And also like window air is actually window space air. So you have also misspellings. And so I was kind of shocked by how bad people are at spelling. Like for the just for the anecdote, is like part of the products were around toilets, and is like I think I counted like 13 ways people spell toilets. And like, toilets is not a complicated word, right? And so we ended up having to do also a lot of pre-processing to detect like a common misspelling people had, so that we could detect things like a toilet is a T O A L E T, it's probably a toilet, like things like that. So we had to do some normalization. And so on one hand, it's easy. Like you can, like that's where again, like F-sharp is pretty nice. It's like what I really have is I have my raw data and I'm going to pass it into a bunch of transformers, like fix the punctuation, fix the thousands, clean the units, misspellings, this, that, that. And so I have like many steps so that I can have data which is in a state where I can say this string looks like this string. This is easy. The thing which is not easy is what happened was originally like learning a full model took us about 2 minutes. And the moment we started to add pre-processing, it started to go from 2 minutes to 20 minutes. And so this was a bit of a problem because like 20 minutes, essentially what we were saying was 80 minutes was like just cleaning up the data and 2 minutes were the learning. So that was not good and that was very slow. So pre-processing matters, it's slow. Also, I learned that as much as I hate regex, like regex is awesome, so or very useful, so I did a lot of regex. Long story short, here we have a bit of a tension, is like what we want is we want to keep the source data intact, like we should keep the original data the way it is, so that you can reproduce my research from the data set. But if I do that, I'm going to be slow, so I probably want to do some caching, because caching is going to be fast. So this quote I came across like recently, and the point here is like so there are only two hard problems. One is cache invalidation, the other one is being willing to relocate to San Francisco. So the good news is like the San Francisco part I have done already, but like the cache invalidation is like whenever you have to deal with the cache, it's bad news. Like if you can avoid it, like you should probably avoid it. But here we kind of had to do it. And so what we did was something, the short version is this, like what we did is like we kept the same structure, but we introduced a bit of a cache so that like every time we do the data loading, we had a local cache on the machine. We looked at the pre-processing file, which is describing all that workflow, hash it, and if the hash changes, I would recompute all the cache, otherwise I would not do it. So this was pretty nice because if I don't change the caching, it's like I would be blazing fast because I will have a local cache. And if you check out the code on your machine for the first time, you're going to take a hit of 20 minutes of pre-processing, but after that it will be blazing fast. So that worked really nicely for us. Conclusion. First conclusion in general is like, so maybe it's obvious, but like, don't be religious about the process. Like, it's not because Scrum, Waterfall, whatever works for you that it will work in every case. What worked for us here was like, take a step back, look at what we do, and like, why is it that we follow a process? Look at where we waste energy, and try to fix that part so that we can be productive and flexible around the places where you want to spend time and spend as little time as possible on the dumb parts and make that repeatable to death. The second part was like statically typed languages are great and functional languages are great. They are great because compared to Python and R, they give you like super nice scripts, super nice data pipelines. You get type checking so you know that your model is going to work and you're not going to crash at runtime in production. And it just works. Like, and the pieces I don't like, or I think I didn't do completely. So there's still some pieces where I'm not happy with what we did. One of them, so what was good was moving features from embedded in scripts to one script or like one file where I have my catalog of features. The thing I don't really like is that I can't really see the history of individual features. Like if I take my model at different points in time, I'm going to see that I used feature one, but perhaps somebody changed that feature over time. And I can't really see that. And that's kind of part of the history of my model. So the versioning is not great on this. The second thing I don't like is like I pushed towards having a code which looks like the problem I'm describing or the domain. And one thing which is missing is experiments. I don't have an entity which is called an experiment, and I don't know how to do that yet. The third one, which is complicated, which is also related to versioning, is now pre-processing is a separate step. So it's very practical. It speeds up the computation. The problem is now...